just so you're aware, I'm working on it. I should have an answer for you here.
Okay. Okay, cool.
Because, you know, it's a motion, you know, motion to proceed yesterday. So we'll see what happens at the NDA amendments.
We got to see if we can maybe have some time to talk next week on the models.
I suppose. You saw there.
Put it in the binder.
No, which old binder?
The subcommittee will come to order. After recognizing myself and Ranking Member Deutsch, who came 7 minutes before me today, for 5 minutes each for our opening statements, I will then move immediately to the witnesses for their opening statements. And without objection, the witnesses' prepared statements will be made a part of the record, and members may have 5 days to insert statements and questions for the record, subject to the length limitation of the rules. And the reason we're zooming right along is because, for the audience, thank you, and for our witnesses, at 1:30 approximately, we will have the first series of votes, and there are 15 votes. So I don't think we want to keep you guys waiting for about 3 hours, so thank you so much. The chair recognizes herself for 5 minutes. It is time that we dispense with the administration charade that our anti-ISIL strategy is a success. In Iraq, ISIL holds almost a third of the country's territory and controls major strategic population centers in Mosul, Fallujah, and Ramadi. While Secretary Carter may blame the Iraqi military for not having the will to fight in Ramadi, Prime Minister Abadi has strongly denied it and said yesterday that he is not receiving the arms and support necessary for him to take on ISIL. In Syria, ISIL controls half the country's territory, according to the Syrian Observatory for Human Rights. ISIL's capture of Tadmor, adjacent to the ancient city of Palmyra, gives them control of a strategic crossroads and unrestricted access to Iraq's Anbar province. There are some success stories where we have been able to push ISIL back from its positions, but ISIL continues to spread into other areas as well. ISIL is already in Libya, Egypt, Nigeria, Afghanistan, and Pakistan. It is also creeping closer to Jordan and Lebanon, and Syrian foreign fighters have even reached our own hemisphere in the Caribbean. ISIL and its ideology are metastasizing across the region. Foreign fighters are pouring into Iraq, to Syria, to Libya. Billions of people have been displaced. Millions of people have been displaced, putting strains on our allies, and there are humanitarian crises throughout the Middle East. Our train and equip program in Syria is now only just getting off the ground, and according to the latest reports, only 2,000 fighters have been identified, 400 have been vetted, only 90 have begun training. On top of that, this past weekend, one of the Syrian commanders participating in the U.S. train and equip program threatened to withdraw 1,000 of his fighters from the program because a DOD official said he'd have to promise not to attack Assad. Incredibly, this is the same Assad who, according to press reports and the Twitter account of the U.S. Embassy Syria yesterday, is providing advanced air support for ISIL and is actively seeking to bolster ISIL's position against the Syrian population in the moderate stronghold of Aleppo. The same Assad whose brutality the embassy is now admitting is ISIL's best recruiting tool and who is being propped up by an Iranian regime using the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps, its proxy Hezbollah, and thousands of foreign fighters to fight on Assad's behalf. The same Assad who failed to disclose his entire chemical weapons arsenal and is using barrel bombs and chemical weapons to kill hundreds of thousands of his own people, almost a quarter of a million by last count. And yet we're going to make our small number of trained Syrian fighters promise not to fight this monster? Iran is also funneling Assad billions of dollars to ensure his survival. And since money is fungible, these are the same billions that were unfrozen as part of the disastrous nuclear negotiations. Our strategy in Iraq cannot and must not be separated from a strategy in Syria, one that removes Assad and a strategy that takes on Iran. Iran is not and will not work in the interest of the United States, no matter what dreams the administration might have. You cannot heal sectarian tensions in Iraq while allowing Iran to exacerbate them, including through its Shiite militias that are said to have committed horrific human rights violations. You cannot stop the flow of foreign fighters without getting tough on Turkey. And you cannot expect to have success with a minimal airstrike campaign which refuses to deploy forward spotters to improve targeting. Our train and equip program in Iraq is scheduled to bring together approximately 5 to 10,000 people, including while ISIL is gaining 1,000 recruits per month. We cannot wait a year for this program to be up and ready. The administration has laid out some lines of effort as part of its anti-ISIL strategy, including military and humanitarian support and counter-finance and counter-narrative efforts that we must continue with greater energy and better efficiency. But they do not address the fundamental miscalculations that this administration continues to make with regard to Assad and with regard to Iran, and they do not inspire confidence that this administration has much of a strategy at all. Beyond these basic contradictions of strategy, here are a few suggestions that I hope the administration, Congress, and others consider immediately. Destroy or neutralize Assad's air capabilities. Sanction Assad and his military officials to hasten the collapse of his regime. Sanction any entity, including the Russians and Iranians, that are propping up Assad. Listen to our military commanders who say we should at least discuss the possibility of boots on the ground, including U.S. Special Forces in Iraqi military units. Also, stop telegraphing to our enemies that what we are not willing to do. And urge the Gulf Cooperation Council, the GCC, countries to put their boots on the ground. Consider the best way to equip anti-ISIL forces in Iraq, whether that's by directly arming the Kurds, the Sunni tribes, or integrated units. And finally, the United States Congress should approve an authorization for the use of military force that goes a lot farther than what the President has requested and appropriately characterizes the scale, goals, capabilities, and identity of the enemy. These are all ideas that could change our approach to ISIL from one of the bare minimum, which is what we have now, to one that is actually having a positive impact that the president claims that he desires. With that, I turn to my friend, the ranking member, Mr. Deutsch.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Thanks for our witnesses for appearing here today to help us understand what happened in Ramadi and how it affects the international effort to combat ISIS in Iraq and Syria. ISIS fighters have been on the outskirts of Ramadi for nearly a year and a half, and while Iraqi security forces had maintained fragile control over most of the city, there had been new heavy fighting in areas under ISIS control for months. In the midst of a sandstorm, ISIS fighters detonated a series of bombs that, as the New York Times described it, allowed it to take advantage of a pause in airstrikes and overwhelm Iraqi forces. While it would be a mistake to compare the fall of Ramadi to the swift fall of Fallujah or Mosul, nonetheless, it was a serious setback with devastating consequences for the innocent civilians of Ramadi, the morale of Iraqi troops, and for the U.S. and coalition strategy. The capture of Ramadi was further compounded by ISIS's seizure of the ancient city or Syrian city of Palmyra the following day. The fall of Ramadi, unfortunately, gave ISIS a public relations win. It now holds the capital of Anbar province, the largest Sunni province in Iraq. This is why now more than ever, it's critical that the Iraqi government ramps up its outreach to Sunni tribal areas and pushes ahead with Prime Minister Abadi's stated goals of an inclusive government and society. The United States should be actively engaged in advising and supporting Prime Minister Abadi in these efforts. And while the popular mobilization forces and other Shiite militias have been effective on the battlefield, the Abadi government must have an active strategy in place to ensure that these militias do not exploit the areas they help defend or liberate. In the days after Ramadi fell, Secretary of Defense Carter made the bold assessment on national television that Iraqi troops have no will to fight. For years, the U.S. has invested heavily in the training of Iraqi forces. So why does it continue to appear, at least, that Iraqi forces are dropping their weapons and running? Is this an accurate portrayal of what occurred in Ramadi despite months of reinforced U.S. training? I hope our witnesses will speak to that. The administration does have a strategy to combat ISIS, but I have to question how we can be effective against a group that seems to constantly adapt. This conflict needs a comprehensive strategy that doesn't just defeat ISIS on the battlefield, but also cuts off its funding and its propaganda machine. And I'm unsure as to whether we are being successful in those areas, and I hope our witnesses will speak to that as well. The victories in Ramadi and Palmyra just weeks ago gave ISIS the appearance of having momentum on its side. Now, in Syria yesterday, ISIS advanced on opposition-held territory north of Aleppo. Reports from opposition leaders claim there seemed to have been coordination with the regime, with Assad's air force striking in what seemed to be support of ISIS ground campaign. And I would welcome our witnesses' assessment of these claims, and if true, what that means going forward. Now, I've admittedly been frustrated by what seems to be a lack of attention to the Syrian front of this conflict. And we'll never effectively degrade and destroy ISIS if we don't simultaneously deal with the problem of the heinous Assad regime, which opened the space for ISIS's rise to begin with. Part of this conflict is a result of sheer lack of governance. In many areas, ISIS is filling a void in terms of services and security. We've heard time and time again that in many parts of Syria, people have aligned with ISIS not because of ideological agreement, but because it was the only group offering them protection. The international community needs to focus greater attention on a long-term solution, and I was pleased to hear General Allen's comments yesterday that there is no place for Assad in a long-term Syria solution. Now, I'm concerned with the growing chorus of frustration with the U.S. that we hear from the Syrian opposition. And while our train and equip programs are now slowly advancing, the question is, are we being as effective as possible in supporting the Syrian opposition? And finally, I'd like to take just a remaining moment or two to remind everyone, the American people and the international community, of the devastating humanitarian crisis in Iraq and Syria. The people of Syria continue to suffer under Assad's barbarity. Barrel bombs, chlorine gas attacks, ongoing brutal repression. In Iraq, the number of displaced people grows daily as ISIS moves in on new territory. Women and children are at extreme risk of violence, and we continue to hear reports of hundreds of people slaughtered in days. We have to remember that the real and grave consequences that this conflict is having on innocent civilians. Madam Chairman, I know that you share these concerns. I thank you for your continued commitment to drawing attention to the humanitarian aspect of this devastating conflict. It's one that must continue to be at the forefront of all of our discussions. And I would offer thanks again to our witnesses for appearing here today. Look forward to your insights, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you so much, Mr. Deutsch. I'll recognize members for 1 minute for their opening statements, starting with Mr. Issa of California.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thanks for bringing this distinguished panel before us today. I'm going to be particularly interested in hearing from Dr. Spence. Fact is, we are dealing today with a policy that he was at the center of and is intimately familiar with. This is not some sort of hypothetical. We have been fighting a war that is in fact fighting against a tide. We have continuously found ourselves siding with organizations like the Maliki government, one in which the Shia are perfectly happy to repress the Sunni, but not willing to fight to protect the Sunni from extremism. The Sunnis, on the other hand, are perfectly willing to allow others to fight for them, but they certainly are not in a position to remove a Sunni extremist group only to be, again, held hostage to a government that still has former Prime Minister Maliki in many ways as the puppeteer of that regime. The fact is that when Ash Carter, rightfully so, said that we do have an inherent problem, I began looking and saying, when did we have that problem last? And the answer was, the last time we had this problem, we were backing Chiang Kai-shek over Mao Zedong. And the reality is, we are not picking the sides at this time in Syria or Iraq in a way in which we can find a path with active support to a solution that the American people can believe in. And I look forward to asking each of the witnesses a series of questions. I thank the chairwoman for her indulgence.
Thank you, Mr. Issa. Ms. Frankel.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I really have one significant question that I'd like each of you to address, if you could. And what I'd like to know is this fight or struggle against ISIL, in your opinion, is it going to require the United States to put more troops in harm's way? That's my question. I yield back.
Thank you so much, Ms. Frankel. I now would like to introduce our expert witnesses. First, we're pleased to welcome back Dr. Michael Rubin, who is a resident scholar at the American Enterprise Institute. Dr. Rubin is a former DOD advisor on international security affairs and a senior editor of the Middle East Quarterly. Dr. Rubin was also a lecturer at Johns Hopkins University, as well as a senior lecturer at the Naval Postgraduate School. Welcome, Dr. Rubin. Second, we welcome Dr. Anthony Kordsman, the Arle Burke Chair in Strategy at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. Previously, he has served as the Director of Intelligence Assessment in the Office of Secretary of the Defense, as well as Director of Policy and Planning at the Department of Energy. Welcome, Dr. Kordsman. And last but certainly not least, we also want to welcome back Dr. Matthew Spence. Dr. Spence is a senior fellow at Yale University's Jackson Institute for International Affairs. Formerly, he served as the Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for the Middle East and has served in the White House as Special Assistant to the President and Director of International Economics at the National Security Council. Welcome, gentlemen, and we will start with Dr. Rubin.
Chairman Ros-Lehtinen, Ranking Member Deutsch, honorable members, thank you for the opportunity to testify. I have submitted in my written testimony detailed analysis and recommendations, but as time is short, please allow me only to highlight a few key points. Suffice to say, the U.S. strategy to degrade and ultimately destroy the Islamic State has not succeeded. Any comprehensive strategy will combine the diplomatic with the military. There is a correlation between Turkey's visa policies and those nationalities which travel to the Islamic State. Moroccans and Tunisians either do not need visas to enter Turkey or can get them on demand. Algerians, however, need visas. While several thousand Moroccans and Tunisians have traveled to Syria, only a handful of Algerians have, though Algerians fight for the Islamic State elsewhere. A no-cost, high-value reform would be for Turkey to end visa waivers or visas on demand for those under the age of 40 from countries which provide the bulk of Islamic State recruits. Drying up the flow of recruits across the Turkish-Syrian frontier is essential. The Iraqi army does fight. They fought in Ramadi for months before losing. They regained control in Beji. That the Islamic State can deploy hundreds and even hold parades shows a lack of U.S. intelligence and/or unwillingness to use air power to maximum advantage. The Iraqi military must maintain its qualitative military edge. If U.S. authorities do not believe it wise to provide weaponry to the Iraqi army, then they must substitute air power, special forces, and trainers to assist Iraqi forces. While it is essential all allies be armed, some seek advantage from the crisis to strengthen their own political hand vis-a-vis rivals. Under Prime Minister Abadi, Baghdad has supplied both light and medium weaponry to the Kurdistan regional government, including MRAPs. The Kurds have also imported weaponry directly from Iran, Germany, Hungary, and Bulgaria. According to the State Department, the Kurds have anti-tank missiles that Baghdad does not have but needed in Ramadi. Alas, the Kurds still distribute weapons to Peshmerga based on political loyalty to the Kurdistan Democratic Party rather than to areas of greatest need. This puts Kirkuk at risk. The United States must coordinate deliveries through Baghdad, but monitor their distribution both from Baghdad to Kurdistan and then from Kurdish authorities to the front where needed. Rather than exacerbate divisions by providing weaponry on an ethnic or sectarian basis, U.S. equipment should be designated for Iraqi army units which incorporate Iraqi diversity. Providing weaponry directly to Iraqi Kurdistan or Sunni tribes empowers hardline pro-Iranian factions and undercuts Abadi and his more moderate allies across the Shiite spectrum. We cannot look a gift horse in the mouth. The group with the greatest success against the Islamic State have been the Syrian Kurds. They are not perfect, but they are secular, tolerant religiously, and generally ethnically as well, and a relative haven for women's freedom. Washington should not treat Syrian Kurds as pariahs simply out of deference to Turkey, which has proven itself an unreliable ally at best. The long-term cost of Iranian military presence in Iraq is greater than the gain derived from Iranian personnel battling the Islamic State. Iranian units exacerbate sectarianism. Still, the United States must differentiate between Iranian-backed militias and Shiite volunteers. Not every Shiite is an Iranian puppet, but painting them all with the same brush risk creating a self-fulfilling prophecy. U.S. diplomats should work with the Iraqi government to create the bureaucratic reforms necessary to implement bottom-up administrative federalism in liberated districts. This involves changes in administrative law and procedure rather than constitutional amendments. U.S. officials must not incentivize sectarian violence by rewarding it, even as they try to bolster the central government's delivery of services across ethnic and sectarian lines. We must recognize that the motivation for the Islamic State is ideological and not based in petty political grievances. That recruitment and residence of the Islamic State reaches from Malaysia to Morocco illustrates this. It's not all about Baghdad. Unless and until there is bipartisan consensus to do what is necessary to defeat the Islamic State before it targets the American homeland, and until there is an authorization for the use of military force that empowers rather than restricts American forces combating the Islamic State, then it would be unfair to American servicemen to put them in harm's way. Likewise, it would be dangerous to conflate the mission to defeat the Islamic State with a very different peacekeeping mission afterwards. That's a mission about which we seldom talk. And with that, I conclude my remarks. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rubin. Dr. Cordesman.
Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to testify. It is possible to focus on the immediate issue.
Hold your microphone a little bit closer. Thank you.
It's possible to focus on the immediate issue in Ramadi. And yet, when I look at Tikrit, I'm not sure that it was any more of a victory. If you lose the population, if you lose the city as a functioning area, if essentially you liberate a desert that simply has buildings in it, you have not achieved a goal. And I think both are a warning of a word you use, Madam Chairman, repetitively, the need for a strategy and for a recognition that no one defeat or issue here is critical. The problem is to have some consistent way of dealing with this over a period of years. Yes, I think we need to look beyond ISIL and al-Nusra and focus on the broader problems and tensions in both Iraq and Syria. I think it is clear you can't have a successful strategy in Western Iraq that doesn't deal with the problems in Eastern Syria. We cannot ignore Iran and focus on the nuclear issue to the exclusion of the other threats that are affected here. Frankly, the train and assist mission to me has been too limited, badly focused, and too distant from the front and the need to actually work with combat forces from the start. Repeats mistakes I have seen in other wars, and it is an area where we do need change. The air campaign is one where, at least publicly, we have not been able to explain either what we are doing or what its focus is. And it certainly seems to be too limited to achieve a key level of effectiveness. We don't seem to be able to explain the weapons flow that actually reaches Iraqi troops or the problems that our train and assist group has in working with them. But having said all of that, which affects the short-term goal, what bothers me on the basis of what happened in our previous war in Iraq and in Afghanistan is if you do not have a strategy which is public and a real strategy, if you do not have requirements to report on the progress you have in meeting that strategy, whether it works, what it costs, and whether it is successful, you go on from incident to incident without ever really being able to assess what you are doing or demonstrating you have a coherent plan to deal with it. We don't have the equivalent of a 1230 report coming out of the Department of Defense. We have no meaningful reporting coming out of the Department of State. After some 50 years in the United States government, I have never seen a more meaningless report on the structure of a war than came out of the so-called lead inspector general on inherent resolve. It is, as a public relations exercise, inept. And what I am suggesting is that as you react to this defeat, there are some concrete steps you can take. You can't legislate strategy, but you can insist that one be reported on. You can demand that that strategy be explained in terms of some form of net assessment. You can call for milestones, estimates of resources, progress reporting, and real measures of effectiveness. You can create the equivalent of a special inspector general, as you did in terms of Iraq and the Afghan war. You can force regular outside and independent reporting on where we are going, and you can have that assess the costs and the measures of effectiveness. These are measures which I think may be longer term than the more immediate suggestions I made in my written testimony. But quite frankly, if we go on with even less understanding, transparency, and responsibility than we managed to have in reporting on the Iraq War and the Afghan War, I don't think that any reaction to one defeat or one set of problems is going to be relevant. We simply have to establish a basis for a strategy, transparency, and credibility.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cordesman. Dr. Spence.
Thank you, Chairman Ros-Lehtinen, Ranking Member Deutsch, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. Thank you for inviting me to speak with you today about the situation in Iraq and our strategy to combat ISIL. I value talking regularly with you in my role in the Department of Defense, and I appreciate continuing to have that candid dialogue in my personal capacity now. The ISIL threat is complex, and the situation is rapidly evolving. I will summarize my statement with the following three areas. First, let me briefly outline how I view the current strategy to counter ISIL. Second, I will offer some reflections about what happened in Ramadi and what we can learn from it. And third, I will share a few thoughts about how we can adjust the current strategy given the rapidly changing battlefield environment. Quite frankly, the enemy is adapting and learning, and we must as well. The events in Ramadi in the past weeks have created an extremely serious situation. We must learn from ISIL's successes in Ramadi and adapt to new conditions on the battlefield. But we also cannot view Ramadi as the sole referendum on a long-term strategy to combat ISIL. The causes of ISIL's rise are deep and complex. It is a tenacious and adaptive enemy. It operates in a joint battlefield between Iraq and Syria. Combating ISIL, therefore, requires a joint strategy towards Iraq and Syria. Taking on ISIL and Iraq alone will not accomplish our objectives. We need to think regionally as well as strategically, and Iran plays a complex role, both fighting ISIL on its own while also pursuing a broader destabilizing agenda in the region. That is why combating ISIL requires a long-term campaign that will take several years, and we are in the first year of what was designed as a multi-year campaign. Now let me offer some context, if I may. Last June, ISIL moved across Iraq with unprecedented speed and stunned the world with its military victories. The underlying causes of ISIL's success, however, were more than weapons and battlefield tactics. Assad's brutality and the conflict in Syria created chaos that allowed ISIL to seize territory. The border between Iraq and Syria became effectively meaningless. The Iraqi government alienated large segments of the Sunni population and was not governing effectively, and lacked the required senior professional military leaders to direct Iraqi security forces. These political conditions will not change overnight, and they cannot be changed with military force alone. That said, recognizing that military force alone cannot effectively address ISIL does not mean that military power does not have a significant role. It does. There are many elements of the United States strategy, trying to work on the terrorist foreign fighters, the ideology, and the terrorist funding. I'll just focus briefly on what I see are three elements of the military aspect of the strategy. The first part of the strategy is political. As I said, ISIL thrives on corruption, alienation, weak governance, and the ensuing political chaos. No amount of soldiers we could deploy, even the best trained Americans and Iraqis, can fill the vacuum of poor governance. The Iraqi governments must take the lead in designing, executing, and maintaining military operations. America cannot be more committed to Iraq's success than Iraq is. Second, however, a key part of our military efforts must be the use of unique and powerful American and coalition military capabilities. We must use unique U.S. and coalition military capabilities to gain an advantage over ISIL. We should not be fighting a fair fight against ISIL, and we should use our unique capabilities from the air. The combination of U.S. and coalition partner air power with Iraqi and Peshmerga ground operations has pushed back Iraq and has made a difference. We need to be doing more with our air power, however. And then finally, because air power alone cannot create the conditions on the ground to combat ISIL, a third and key element of our strategy must be focusing on building the capacity of the Iraqi security forces, Peshmerga ground forces, as well as local fighters in Syria. Now that said, I want to briefly recommend a few adjustments to our strategy. And in recommending those adjustments, I briefly want to recommend four principles to keep in mind. First, our efforts should be built around sustainability. Will additional U.S. support create the incentives for the Iraqi forces to own the fight? Second, we must balance any support the United States provides against the risk to American service members. Third, we cannot view ISIL in isolation in Iraq. Coalition forces cannot fight Iraq in ISIL in Iraq only to allow them sanctuary in Syria. And fourth, the United States must support and maintain the international coalition. Given that, if I may, I briefly recommend adjustments in each of the areas I mentioned before. First, in training, four deployed U.S. Special Forces advisors within Iraqi units should be used more. Such forces have been deployed in Al-Asad Air Base in western Anbar. U.S. Special Forces can be deployed in eastern Anbar as a platform for working with Sunni tribes in the east. Embedding U.S. forces can help inject energy into leadership development of new and weaker Iraqi commanders and help stand them up more quickly. It was the failure of unit leadership in Iraq, the failure of that type of leadership, which is necessary for good organization and good morale, which I think explains some of what we saw in the recent weeks. Second, in U.S. unique military assets, we must make better use of air power. Expanded target sets for U.S. and coalition aircraft should be needed. Now, this must be done carefully to minimize civilian casualties. However, we should consider deploying forward American coalition air controllers to remove our targeting and expediting airstrikes. We must surge in better weapons to take on the large suicide truck bombs which caused such devastation that we saw in the past weeks. And then finally, politically, the United States and coalition forces must press the Iraqi government harder to more actively enlist Sunni fighters in this campaign. In conclusion, Madam Chairman, what I would say is Iraq and Syria show us what a tremendous adversary ISIL is. They are adopting quickly. They are learning. We must be more nimble with them. This is what I recommend now, but as the situation evolves, we should not fail to look at more bold options as things have adjusted to adjust to the realities of what the enemy is doing on the battlefield. Thank you for the opportunity.
Excellent recommendations. Thank you to all of our panelists. I'll begin the question and answer period. I wanted to ask our panelists to comment on today's New York Times article that says Assad's forces may be aiding new ISIS surge. Building on recent gains in Iraq and Syria, Islamic State militants are marching across northern Syria toward Aleppo, Syria's largest city, helped along, their opponents say, by the forces of President Bashar al-Assad. The rebels complain that the United States has refrained from contributing air support to help them fend off simultaneous attacks by the government and the Islamic State. And the article continues, the Twitter account of the long-closed United States Embassy in Syria made its strongest statement yet about Mr. Assad's tactics. Reports indicate that the regime is making airstrikes in support of ISIL's advance on Aleppo, aiding extremists against Syrian populations, the embassy said in a series of Twitter posts. In another post, it added that the government warplanes were not only avoiding ISIL lines, but actively seeking to bolster their position. Neither American officials nor Syrian insurgents have provided proof of such direct coordination, though it has long been alleged by the insurgents. Dr. Rubin, what do you make of that?
I would say that President Assad makes Machiavelli look like Mother Teresa. You know, when I'm in the region, oftentimes I hear the conspiracy theory, which is pervasive, that the Americans are behind the Islamic State, and this is a conspiracy theory which has been pushed forward by Supreme Leader Ali Khamenei of Iran on numerous occasions. The way I counter this is to remind people that before the United States began air operations in Syria, the Islamic State was still centered at Raqqa. The Syrian Air Force, under the command of Bashar al-Assad, had dominance over the skies of Syria. And rather than take on the Islamic State, he preferred to drop barrel bombs on Syrian civilians. So I fully concur that we may have a situation in which Bashar al-Assad is acting in a way that might not appear at first glance logical, or that Bashar al-Assad may not be as committed to defeating the Islamic State as some people would like to argue.
Thank you. And to the, our other witnesses, I wanted to ask you, what are the dangers of if the administration again relies on Russia or Iran in the fight against ISIL this time? Because just yesterday, Deputy Secretary of State Tony Blinken held a press availability with the Prime Minister Abadi and the French Foreign Minister following a meeting of some of the coalition partners in the fight against ISIL. He was asked a question by a reporter about the U.S. May have told Iraq that Baghdad will be able to buy weapons from Russia and Iran. And it just seems like, is that the right message we should be sending? Or what should we be doing in respect to relying on Russia and telling Baghdad it's okay to rely on Russia and Iran?
Well, let me begin.
Dr. Kordsman.
Let me begin by saying first, Iran has provided weapons and aircraft to Iraq. Russia has provided weapons. And Iraq is a sovereign country, and if it chooses to use its own money to buy weapons from other countries, these are not some things where we can do more than attempt to influence the situation. What would bother me much more seriously is exactly what is the strategy we are using to arm and develop the Iraqi forces. How well does the train and assist mission actually work in ensuring the arms get there, or even to the training base? Because there have been major problems simply in getting low-level training ammunition into rear area training activities. We're not going to be able to limit all of these things by asking them not to go to other suppliers. The real issue, I think, is, are we going to provide an effective, timely flow, and one that gives us the kind of influence and leverage that can help push them both toward unity and military effectiveness? I think that's the key issue.
Thank you, Dr. Kordsman. Dr. Spence.
Madam Chairman, I think sound strategy requires looking two steps ahead. In the near term, Iran is fighting ISIL, and we have a shared enemy. In the longer term, Iran has a more destabilizing agenda, both in Iraq to have control of large parts of the Iraqi state and in Syria as well. And we should be under no illusions of what a long-term overt partnership with Iran would do. So in the near term, as Dr. Kordsman said, there's a reality of the funding that Iran and weaponizing that Iran is conducting. However, as we do this, we need to look at the steps ahead would be what the consequences would be if we knowingly allowed Iran to get a type of foothold in these places with its larger destabilizing region has. Ultimately, what we need to do is make sure we have more stable and effective governance, not just when ISIL is driven out, but there is something strong to put in place in the vacuum that will be left when ISIL is gone.
Thank you so much, gentlemen. Dr. Mr. Deutsch is recognized.
Hardly. Thank you, Madam Chairman. Dr. Spence, let me follow up on that last point, which is what's going to be there when ISIL is gone. Can you, in your rightful efforts to look two steps ahead, what should that look like?
You know, Congressman, I think it's enormously difficult, and it's different in Iraq and in Syria. I mean, the basic principle is there needs to be an inclusive government that both Sunnis as well as Shiite or Alawites feel a stake in the central government, that they don't need to turn to some other non-state actor. Executing that is very hard. I think in Iraq, what it looks like in large parts is trying to enlist local fighters to fight against ISIL in the areas where they are. They have an incentive, they know their area better, and we need to have these types of Sunni fighters who have an incentive to stop ISIL from murdering their families, but also be brought into some larger structure in the Iraqi government. So I think it's largely recruiting local fighters. In Syria, it's much, much harder because as imperfect a partner as a body is, even though he's taking good steps, we have the opposite of that in Syria. Of course, we have an enemy in Assad. And I think that's why, as slow as the train and equip program in Syria is moving, that's why trying to recruit and train and find some Syrian fighters to get some victories in villages in Syria that we've been trying to work with and create some good government can also provide the military muscle to provide both governance as well as some stable sense of state authority. So there's a real alternative between the devil of Assad and the other devil that is ISIL.
Can we really be successful in our train and equip in Syria if the focus, if we're training and equipping only to take on ISIS when Assad continues to drop barrel bombs and chlorine on his own people?
You know, it's hard. I mean, I think in any event, the most immediate threat to American interests still are ISIL, but the longer cause that allowed ISIL to take place is, of course, Assad. Now, part of the issue that we face is, you know, the program as authorized by Congress is not authorized to take on Assad. You know, one of the purposes of the program is to create the conditions to create a political settlement to do that. The issue we face right now, I think, before we were to openly take on Assad in a military way, we need to be very clear about what happens in day two and the years that would follow. And right now, I think we need to do more work to strengthen the opposition to do that before we would have a concerted effort right now to go after Assad. I think it's an issue of timing and sequencing.
Right. Dr. Rubin, as we assess what to do in Syria, we don't want to be in a position, do we, where we succeed in pushing back ISIS only to be left with an al-Qaeda-backed government there?
That's correct. And within, you can't allow a safe haven to develop anywhere. Terrorists love a vacuum, and ungoverned spaces are a chief problem, both in Iraq and in areas under ISIS control, and in Syria. One of the problems in Iraq post-liberation of territories seized by ISIS is going to be the leadership of the Sunni community. And the problem is the Kurds have a definite leadership, the Shiites have a definite leadership. Saddam Hussein cut off the Sunni leadership at its knees, and it never really has redeveloped. Some in the Sunni leadership had tried to gamble with the Islamic State, assuming they could use it as a wedge against Prime Minister Maliki. They failed. They've lost support. The question is, what strategy do we have to build this up? Because at this point, when the Sunnis go to Prime Minister Abadi, their chief demand is not to listen to any of the other Sunni groups who are going to Prime Minister Abadi.
Dr. Cordesman, in Iraq, can you comment on Secretary Carter's assessment of Iraqi forces and whether it's an accurate assessment to suggest that that perhaps they don't have the will to defend themselves? Where does the truth lie? If there's any truth to that, then what is it ultimately that we can hope to accomplish if that's the case?
First, I think there is a will to fight depending on the unit. Part of the problem is that under Maliki, you use the military forces essentially as a political weapon to suppress opposition and against the Sunni population. The legacy is what happened that virtually destroyed a good part of the Iraqi army. Rebuilding that, we have said, will take several years. Now, one of the units in Ramadi actually held together quite well for a long amount of time. It eventually simply was worn out. And one of the problems you have when you talk about the will to fight is you need to look at the order of battle. Remember, they're on the scene, that is the Islamic State or ISIL's forces. They know the weaknesses in the local Iraqi forces. If they can smash through or in, go around the better units, take advantage of the weaker units or the police, they can disrupt and shatter a defense over time, and they've done that. But it is also true, if you want the will to fight, you need a government that can get ammunition and reinforcements there on time. The problems are not simply forward. They're just as serious throughout the entire structure of Iraqi defense. And if we don't really find a way to advise and assist to deal with the broad operations, you're going to have unit after unit, unless this changes, which runs out of ammunition, isn't reinforced in time, isn't pulled out, and is exhausted, and you're going to find this repeated.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you so much, Mr. Deutsch. Votes have been moved up from the scheduled time, so I will ask our the rest of our members to limit their question and answer period to 4 minutes so everyone can get a shot at it. Mr. Issa.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have 32 prepared questions. Would you all agree to receive them and respond for the record?
Yes.
Yes.
Let the record reflect that
without
all witnesses objection. Answered in the affirmative. Dr. Spence, with my remaining time, what I'd like to do is I'd like to go through a couple of items that are not in that long list. And one of them is you were both in two different major roles in the administration at a time in which the administration rejected safe havens in Syria, either to deal with the plight of Syrians going to Lebanon or into Jordan or into Turkey. Do you regret that? A yes or no is fine.
No, I don't right now. No.
So you think it's fine that, in fact, Lebanon is essentially more than 25% Syrian refugees. Jordan is maintaining huge amounts of refugees. And in fact, our situation with Turkey is one in which we depend on a Turkish government that is, at best, marginal in their real support for deterring ISIL, while, in fact, they continue to insist that we overturn the Assad government as a precondition to full cooperation. Isn't it time that we begin looking at having territory within Syria in which we control it? He is denied ability to fly, even if it's not to overturn the Assad government, but rather to have a safe haven in which we can prepare Syrian troops to take on ISIL.
I think, you know, in response to your question, I think a few things. I think, first, I'm extremely concerned about the refugee situation, about the neighbors, and I think
the Lebanese appreciate that. Send them a couple $1 billion. Answer the question, because I'm deeply concerned that a failed strategy continues to be used in Syria, one in which we say we're going to take out the Assad government, but we don't, but we're perfectly willing to destabilize that government so that ISIL, in fact, can grow faster than any of the troops that we want to prepare to cause a regime change.
Well, Congressman, I think the issue that we need to focus on is what is the best way accomplishing this end goal that you're talking about, and that's both minimizing the damage in refugees that comes to the countries in the region. In Lebanon, for example, it's not just 25% ISIL refugees. Over half of the country could be refugees. That's enormously concerning. The concern I have about safe havens and what would happen if Assad immediately fell is, what would the results be if it happened right away, and how do we sustain it?
So it's your position as someone who just left the administration that Assad falling from government today would be adverse to our best interest?
I'm not saying that, but I'm saying is before the United States were to take action themselves to push Assad out, we need to think very carefully about what comes in Assad.
So it's during your tenure at National Security and your tenure, obviously, at Defense, do you believe that we could have diminished or eliminated Assad's military supremacy over his own troops and his own country?
I think we are doing a fair amount to do that. I think the goal needs to be, it's not just the fall of Assad, what comes in Assad's
place. So would you say that we used efforts to diminish and eliminate his air supremacy? From my reports, his helicopters, very easy targets for high-performance aircraft, are not, in fact, on a daily basis targets that we go after, and certainly not his air bases. Isn't that correct?
I think there are a number of things that we did to reduce the fighting power of Assad. Both.
No, that wasn't the question. The Assad's ability, as the chairwoman said, Assad's ability to punish their own people, and often their own people and not ISIL, was never diminished. Assad's ability to rain down terror from the air continues today, a capability that I'm sure you agree, Doctor, we had the capability to diminish, and we did not and currently do not. Dr. Cordesman, perhaps you could weigh in on this. I don't think Dr. Spence is going to give me the answer I'd like.
I can give you the answer you'd like. but I think that we do have the ability to put far more pressure on Syria in its use of force than we have exercised. From the start, I think we exaggerated their capabilities and willingness to react to that pressure. And certainly, it isn't just outside refugees. You got 7 million displaced people in the country without homes or jobs.
Or safe havens to live in.
More than
half
the population.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
We all strive to please Mr. Issa, but it's an impossible task. Mr. Higgins of New York is right.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, gentlemen, for being here. You know, coalition forces met recently, and the conclusion was that our strategy is going to continue as it is. You look at Ramadi and Palmyra, and the fact that ISIS troops are far outnumbered by coalition forces. You look at the chaos in Iraq with a fighting force that just doesn't seem to be up for the task. How does this strategy that is in place, how does it succeed? Dr. Rubin?
The strategy which is in place does not succeed. And on September 10th, 2014, the president laid out a goal which was to degrade and destroy the Islamic State. It's clear that that strategy is not working.
Dr. Kordesman?
In all fairness, we've said this would take 2 to 3 years, and it would take us more than a year to train even 9 to 12 Iraqi brigades. But if this strategy is ever going to work, it's going to work far too slowly. It is far from clear that it is going to have anything like the political and civil effects that are necessary, and it is a strategy for Iraq that doesn't seem to have any strategy for Syria. Because if you're training 5,000 people, 90 people at a time, I frankly don't see the point.
Dr. Spence.
I think both the strategy will take time by the ways we're executing it. So first, I think there, of course, is a role for American significant military power, and that must be used. But second, if you're going to be working through local partners, which I think is the sustainable way to do it, training local partners takes time. I mean, the genius of America's military is not the technology we deploy, but it's the leadership, our tactics, and how our men serve in combat. And training that leadership at the unit level takes time and is extremely difficult.
Late last year, there was an announcement that Prime Minister Abadi had agreed to or came to an agreement with the Kurds that they would receive $1 billion for their Peshmerga, and they would receive 17% of national oil revenues in perpetuity. It seemed to be a good start to the new administration in that he appeared to be the prime minister developing a strategy for a coalition to defeat ISIS in Iraq. You know, what happened there, and where's the Peshmerga in these fights?
So I think the Peshmerga in these fights have a few things. I think first, a key part of the strategy needs to continue to be encouraging Abadi to reach out both to the Kurds as well as Sunnis, and the way that he takes steps to do it, and push him to follow through on those commitments. I think on arming the Peshmerga, what the international coalition did in July was try to mobilize an enormous effort to provide large amounts of equipment, training in that, and that has been flowing to Kurdish fighters, and I think that's part of the reasons why we've seen Kurdish fighters able to be effective on the ground in some very, very difficult fights.
Dr. Rubin?
I want to reemphasize the point that the Kurdish regional government has not been fully truthful when they say that they have not received weaponry from the Iraqi government. If they have not received enough weaponry, it's simply because the Iraqi government also has not received enough weaponry. The bigger problem that undercuts Kurdish Peshmerga effectiveness is that the weaponry which the Kurds do have does not always make it to the place of greatest need. It's more distributed on the basis of political patronage. We certainly see this in and around Kirkuk, which seems to be the next target for the Islamic State, but because Kirkuk voted the wrong way in the Kurdish elections, they're simply not getting the weaponry from the Kurdistan central government.
I'll yield back my time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Higgins. Mr. Wilson of South Carolina.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and thank you for having this very important hearing, and each of you, we appreciate you being here today. I particularly appreciate Dr. Rubin, the American Enterprise Institute. I well remember nearly 2 years ago, right here, as our president was falsely claiming that radical Islam was on the run, that the threats to American families was being diminished, that Dr. Kagan was here with a map clearly showing that there was a spread of threats across North Africa, Middle East, and Central Asia. And what he projected at that time, sadly, has come to effect. So we really appreciate AEI presenting information to us. I'm particularly interested in the Kurdish regional government that we have worked with for many years, the Kurdish regional government of Iraq. You were indicating that they have not been properly using the equipment received, but yet I was sincerely hoping that we could continue, obviously, to be working with them for the mutual interest that we have, and that's been in place for decades, and with the no-fly zone, on and on. So how can we work with them and encourage their active and very capable involvement?
Thank you, Congressman, for your kind words. I would say simply trust but verify. And we don't want to get into a situation anywhere in Iraq where we are used as a foil for unrelated political rivalries. So it's essential that we simply don't insist that the Kurds get the weaponry, but we go the extra step and suggest that once they do get the weaponry, they have to show that it's being distributed on the basis of military need. And if that involves American advisors in the various war rooms to help second guess those decisions, so be it.
Well, thank you very much for that insight. And Dr. Cordesman, my whole time being here, I was elected in 2001. So I have not forgotten 9/11. It's on my mind all the time that where there are safe havens for terrorists anywhere in the world, that the American people and American families are at risk of a murderous attack. Again, we saw the attack Osama bin Laden from a cave in Afghanistan. But a greater threat over the last year, it's inconceivable to me that the city of Mosul, a city of nearly a million people, has been under the control of ISIL. How great a threat and as a launching place is it that such a city be under their control?
I think the issue is much broader. As long as they are a growing proto-state, which extends into both Iraq and Syria, they have the ability to attract foreign volunteers, to train them, potentially to use them as people they can use in Europe or the United States to conduct acts of international terrorism. But right now, the odd aspect is they are so caught up in dealing with the al-Nusra Front, Assad, and the Iraqi government that it is a threat which may well become far more serious in the future. The oddity, I'd say, is as we look at Yemen, in spite of what has happened there, al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula is still a critical issue. If you look at al-Qaeda in that map, which Dr. Kagan presented to you several years ago, and you combine it with the ISIL map, it's expanded into many other areas. Those don't have the same internal pressures for conflict, and in many of those, you may find the threat changes and becomes more serious to us or other states.
Thank you so much, Mr. Wilson. Mr. Cicilline.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Dr. Cordesman, in your written testimony, you speak about or write about the need for a civil, military, and whole-of-government strategy for both Iraq and Syria, and you speak about it being largely the responsibility of these individual nations to determine their own destiny, and you, I think, accurately recite a whole series of challenges between, including deeply divided societies, inadequate governance, massive corruption, mismanaged economies, demographic pressures that make a challenging context even in times of peace. In light of that, is our reliance on a strategy that focuses on training and equipping the Iraqi army, the Peshmerga, the Shiite militia, does that have a real possibility of success in any event, or are there things we should be doing differently that might produce a better outcome?
In the case of Iraq, I think the problem is we aren't doing either one particularly thoroughly. you can do serious damage to the Islamic State and to extremism using force. But I think that if you are going to deal with Iraq's civil problems, you need to work very carefully with every element you can in Iraq to move them toward unity, to overcome the kind of problems and divisions that have grown between Sunni and Shiite and Arab and Kurd. One of the things that I think is very discouraging, and one thing that you might want to conduct hearings on, is the idea that what we need in Baghdad is a normal embassy that does not put real pressure for this kind of unity on the Iraqi government. I would want to see exactly what the strategy and the efforts are, whether there are things we could do to encourage federation or reform without attempting to dictate it. And I have not seen any indication of that, at least in public terms. And being reassured in broad terms doesn't help me. In the case of Syria, the issue is far more difficult. One way or another, we have the al-Nusra Front, the Islamic State, Assad, and perhaps some very small groups of Islamists which are more moderate. It has never been explained to me why training 5,000 volunteers a year is going to have any impact on this situation, civil or military. And as was raised earlier, we're talking about essentially 11 million people, refugees or IDPs. So we either have some civil strategy for Syria and a military strategy, or we have a nightmare where anything we do militarily does not bring stability or security.
Thank you. I just have a minute left, so I want to ask Dr. Rubin. Thank you, Doctor. Dr. Rubin, can you just speak briefly about the Kurdistan-Iran relationship? You know, we kind of view this, the opportunities that exist with the Kurds to be a panacea. So I'd like to hear, and also, what more can we be doing to persuade Turkey or to really take seriously their responsibility to stem the flow of foreign fighters and really close their border? Does that continue to be a resource or a pathway for most of the foreign fighters into the region?
Thank you very much. Firstly, make no mistake, on the ground, many Kurds are pro-American. For that matter, many Iraqis, non-Kurdish Iraqis, are also pro-American. However, the Kurds have a history of abandonment. While Americans tend not to have extensive historical memory, Kurds do remember 1975 and 1988, both periods in which they feel that they were betrayed by the United States. On top of that, Iran is their neighbor, and a major Iranian influence operation is that you can like the Americans better, but you're always going to have to live next to us, and the Iranians do tend to exert that pressure a great deal. When I go to both Iraq and Baghdad, Basra, and Kurdistan, Erbil, Soleimania, I'm told, jokingly, that Qasem Soleimani was there 2 weeks ahead of me in each of those cities, including Kurdistan. The danger is that the Americans have let their guard down when it comes to Iraqi Kurdistan, and we don't recognize just how deeply they have been penetrated by the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps and the Quds Force.
Thank you, Mr. Cicilline. Mr. Meadows.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Dr. Spence, let me come to you. You talked about this three-year strategy, you know, that the success is going to take about 3 years, and that's what the administration has said. This is going to be a longer-term strategy. So when originally we came up with this three-year window of success in our fight, was it contemplated at that particular time that ISIL was going to expand their capabilities and acquire all this other new territory? Was that part of what we assumed was going to happen?
Congressman, what I would say is that even though there's a longer-term strategy, we need to have interim report cards, right? You can't just wait to see what happens at the end of 3 years. And of course, to answer your question directly, two things that at the Defense Department we were particularly concerned about are, first, denying territory and safe haven to ISIL, meaning they should not be expanding territory. And then second, to what degree are we building the capacity to the partners doing the fighting? So
agreed.
The first question I'm very, very concerned about.
So they're expanding territory, so I guess our strategy is not working is what I'm saying.
I think
American people believe it's not working, so do you have a different opinion?
The way I would put it, just very candidly, is there will be places where ISIL has expanded, and there are places where ISIL is also in retreat. This is not a homogenous fight. Iraq is not homogenous where ISIL can have control. So to be very blunt, what happened in the last weeks was a significant setback. We should make no bones about it, and we should be very honest about what happened. It was only a setback because this was an area where we had Americans fight and die before. It's a hugely important part of Iraq, but also it creates a sense of momentum. If more of that happens, that becomes very positive.
Well, and that's what I'm seeing is momentum, but part of that is a direct response to our anemic airstrikes, our anemic support, and I guess when are we going to get serious about it? And I say that because under sworn testimony before the Senate Armed Service Committee, we heard testimony that basically that 75% of our sorties that are going out are coming back without deploying their missiles or bombs, and so they're coming back. The other troubling aspect for me is during a 29-day conflict with Gaza and Israel, they were able to put almost 3,000 missiles into Israel, and yet here we are, the most powerful nation in the world, and we, over a four-month period, did less than 1,000 airstrikes in a much larger geographic region. So how is that going to create the fear of the American military might if we're being anemic?
So I don't think we're being anemic now with American air power. That said,
well, less than 15 flights a day. I mean, you get more flights coming in over the National Mall here than you do in Syria and Iraq. So how can you say that it's not anemic?
Look, we have had the sheer number of sorties and weapons dropped and the territory and the ISIL targets that have been taken out have been significant. Now, as I said earlier, I do think we should do whatever we can to make sure that we're expanding the target list and look very carefully to make sure that we're making the best use of air power. So as we think about four deployed air controllers, about American as well coalition forces, I think this is something we should seriously consider, balanced against, of course, the risk to the U.S.
All right, Dr. Rubin, let me go very quickly to you, because what we see is with Turkey contributing to the ISIL, can you speak to that, our strategy with regards to foreign fighters coming in, and I'll yield back to, and let you answer.
Yes, thank you, and thank you also to Representative Cicilline. I didn't get to this part of your question because of time. Basically, I would argue that Turkey has become Pakistan on the Mediterranean, where they're willing to say one thing publicly and do quite another issue. I gave one item in my testimony, both oral and written, which should be a no-brainer on the part of Turkey. It should be a cost-free option to test whether Turkey is sincere or not. But look, Turkey in the late 1990s sealed their border with Syria. So the argument that they cannot seal their border with Syria is nonsense. They simply do not want to. And even if the June 7th election leads to a coalition government, and it's not clear that the election will be free and fair, over the past 10 plus years, President Erdogan and his party have completely shifted the Syria policy, if you will, to the MIT, to Syria's intelligence unit. So even under a coalition government, we're still going to have the problem continue unless there's some serious pressure on President Erdogan to stop the nonsense.
Thank you so much, Mr. Meadows and Mr. DeSantis.
Thank you. I thank the witnesses. And I would just say that the Ramadi setback was something that does resonate with me, just because I know the number of people who fought and died and were injured driving al-Qaeda in Iraq out of Ramadi. That was one of the most dangerous places in the world in 2005, 2006. I was deployed in that area. By the time we left in 2008, it was peaceful. And so to see it go back is something that hurts. Dr. Kordsman, to what extent is Iran supporting the Iraqi forces right now?
And quite frankly, I think you would need to get that answer at a very sensitive level of intelligence. But several things are clear. The Al-Quds force is active. They have provided, for example, Su-25s. Now, they were Iraqi originally till Saddam flew them to Iran. They provided significant numbers of weapons. They have certainly trained and equipped the militias, some of which are seen as more moderate than others. So you have a very active role, and they are forward. So when you have Iraqi troops move forward, there are often Iranians present in small numbers. It's not a matter of volunteers or dominating any aspect of military operations. I think that they have a significant political influence, and they certainly are tying their military actions to trying to give themselves visibility and looking at what they have done and said. They also often, at least quietly, are saying our air power is ineffective, we're not really serious about training, you can't trust us, and they can split the message up between one focused on Shiites and other factions. They're also present in the Kurdish area, and we should have no illusions that this is only something that affects the areas under the Iraqi government control.
Dr. Rubin, what's your view on the extent to which Iran is influencing and directing these anti-ISIL operations in Iraq?
Well, let me put it this way. Iran will take credit for any success that occurs. They're trying to infiltrate. I'd respectfully disagree a bit with Dr. Spence that in the short term, any benefit can be derived from Iranian action inside Iraq. Iran is not an altruistic power. And if the problem, if you're willing to accept that the problem is based in grievance and not simply ideology, and if the grievance has to do with sectarianism, then the Iranian-backed forces are the most sectarian forces there. That said, there's a silver lining if we choose to take advantage of that. Under Prime Minister Maliki, there was a political purge to insert the more pro-Iranian members into Iraqi army units, and they were the ones who fared particularly poorly in Mosul. So this idea that we can derive even military benefit from Iranian prowess, to me, is overstated in the extreme. Look, we have an interest in defeating the Islamic State. The Iranians have an interest also in the Islamic State, but arsonists and firefighters both have interests in fires. It doesn't mean we're on the same side of the issue.
And what about the nuclear agreement or pending agreement? This has obviously unnerved a lot of Sunni Gulf states to see the United States essentially tilting toward Iran. How does that play just kind of on the street for the average Sunni Arab in Al-Anbar province? I mean, if they see the forces is being infiltrated by Iran, they see the U.S. tilting perhaps towards Iran. It just seems like that we're driving them into the arms of ISIS.
Not only are we driving them into the arms of ISIS, but we're going to make the situation far worse down the line. The Khatam al-Anbiya, which is the economic wing of the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, controls about 40% of the Iranian economy. When the Iranians derive this $50 to $100 billion in relief after any nuclear accord, that money isn't going to flow into ordinary Iranians' coffers. I used to live in the Islamic Republic. I can give you any number of anecdotes, but for the sake of brevity, that's going to go directly to the Iranians. Now, between 2000 and 2005, the price of oil doubled, the European Union trade with Iran almost tripled, and under the reformists, the so-called reformists, that hard currency windfall went almost exclusively into Iran's nuclear and ballistic missile capability.
Dr. Rubin, and thank you, Mr. DeSantis. But votes have started, so our wrap-up question and answer period will be led by Dr. Yoho.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I appreciate it. Dr. Spence, you were talking about an inclusive government in Iraq. Is that possible?
In Iraq? Yes, I believe so.
You know, what I see is when Saddam Hussein was there, there was a unified Iraq because he ruled it with an iron fist. But what I see today, in talking to the experts, you have the Sunnis loyal to the Sunnis, Shia loyal to the Shia, Kurds loyal to the Kurds. To be able to be under one unified government, I'm not seeing that work. And I know that was one of the strategies of being able to build these forces that we're going to, you know, all be loyal to the Iraqi flag the way we see unity and loyalty to the American flag. I don't see that happening. And what do the people of Iraq want?
I mean, the different tribal cultures, or you know, the split up of the cultures there. What do they want?
They want much of what most of us want. They want to be represented. They don't want to be pushed out. They don't want to have fear for their lives and their basic needs.
I mean, we all have the basic rights of we want better for our children, better life, and we want certain basic freedoms. But yet, do they see that working together in a unified country made up of different factions or different cultures?
Look, I think there have been, it is hard to do, but there have been some steps taken to your question exactly about what has been done to outreach more. So when Prime Minister Abadi came in, he took some immediate steps to reach out to the Sunnis, which Maliki simply had not done. You know, he appointed, for example, a defense minister who is a Sunni, which is a critical form, a critical post to have had. He fired some of the most political generals who really weren't leading at all. Even after what happened in Ramadi, he called his full cabinet, his national security cabinet together, where it was both Kurds and Sunnis and Shiites to talk about what they need to do necessarily. Within the Iraqi parliament, a bill for a National Guard, which would not just have Shias fighting, has passed a second reading. So steps have been taken to bring some of these fighters in within. It is hard, but things have been done, and I think we just need to push more to happen.
Well, I've seen that, and that you're talking about that National Guard made up of different groups. We tried that with the Iraqi security forces, and they folded like cheap suits. Dr. Cordesman, what is your opinion on that?
I don't think that the security forces universally fold. I think some of them have been exhausted. Better units, for example, were sent into Ramadi, not rotated, not supported, and not reinforced.
Dr. Rubin, how about you?
I've talked to Iraqi insurgents, and I've talked to Shiites. The one area of consensus in which they have is a support for administrative federalism, and by that I mean, while Baghdad would have control over foreign policy and defense, all other decisions would be based on the district or sub-district level, not based on ethnic divisions, although oftentimes those would coincide.
Is that long-term, or is that just to get through the crisis we're in now?
That's long-term.
One more question. All right, let me ask you this about Syria, if we can pivot to Syria. Where is the UN? Has there been a resolution from the UN that comes out and denounces Assad and denounces the civil war in Assad for having a civil war for the hundreds of thousands of people that have been genocide there, destabilizing not just his country, the surrounding countries, the whole Middle East, and basically the world? When you have 7 million refugees, where is the UN in coming out and saying, we're done with this, we're doing an ultimatum, you need to get your country under control in a time period, and the world, the nations of the world stand up? Where has that been done, and why not, if not?
When you ask the question, where is the UN, the answer is usually in a five-star hotel.
Right.
But the real problem with regard to the United Nations on this is it's infused with cultural and moral equivalency. It's not there to solve problems. It's there to avoid solutions.
Well, and I think they do very well at that. And, you know, and then I question, why are we there? Why are we with the UN? And where's the rest of the world? Because what Assad is doing is bad, you know, for everything I just mentioned. And I think the biggest thing is the humanitarian crisis and the strife he's caused in that country to his own people. This has gone on long enough. I would wish the world community would come up and say, this is it. You're done, and it needs to have a regime change. But then I worry about who's going to fill that void, because as we all know, nature abhors a vacuum, and I'm out of time. Thank you.
Thank you,
Dr. Yoho. I got to do my constitutional duty and vote.
Thank you to our panelists. And before we adjourn, I'd like my wonderful congressional interns to stand up and take a bow. We are single-handedly keeping all of these juvenile delinquents off the streets. Thank you, guys. And with that, our subcommittee is adjourned.